afternoon.
Good afternoon.
That sounds funny, doesn't it? Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to this hanging of the green service on this first Sunday of Advent. Pastor Carter, we are so glad to have you with us. I believe that this is a first for First Christian to have a hanging of the green service. So a little orientation to what we're doing and why we're doing it. It is the first Sunday of Advent. Am I on? Am I on now?
On for us, but not for me.
No? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Can you hear me?
You
can hear me? Okay, I'll just talk loud till we get it straightened out. Or if we get, here comes the microphone. Here comes the microphone. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Still can't hear me. Good afternoon.
No.
Good afternoon.
Give her a kiss.
I'm going to use my theater voice and it'll be just fine.
There you go.
It comes on. Welcome to this Hanging of the Greens service at First Christian Church. We are delighted to have you here. So Hanging of the Greens service is about our inauguration of the first Sunday of Advent and entering a new season. And not only a new season, but
a new church year. For those of us who use the liturgical calendar, the first Sunday of Advent begins a whole new year. So Happy New Year, as well as Happy First Sunday of Advent. And so in a Hanging of the Greens service, what we do is we stop and we pay some attention to these symbols of the season that are around us. You see wreaths and bows, and you see greenery and a tree and some gold and white Christmas ornaments. All kinds of things that make our sanctuary beautiful. But each of those things has a special meaning. And so in the Hanging of the Green service, we're going to unpack the meaning of those symbols, and we're also going to enjoy singing some Christmas carols. So as our service unfolds, you'll hear a reading about a symbol. We'll see that symbol on display, and we will enjoy some music together. On our congregational carols, we're not going to announce those carols. We'll just roll straight into them, and we'll stand as we sing. So I'll invite you to have your hymnal at the ready. Our first carol, People Look East, is mislabeled in your bulletin. It is a congregational carol, so please stand and sing when we do People Look East. And that is how our service will go today. Let us enter into a time of worship and of celebration together.
Please stand as you are able for our call to worship. In the days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised above the hill. All the nations shall stream to it. Many peoples shall come and say,
come.
Let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that God may teach us God's ways, and that we may walk in God's paths. A child or youth says, with what shall we come to God's house? Bring branches of cedar and holly, bring evergreens and pine tree, hang wreaths and garlands. Make the church fragrant with the smell of living things and our holy play. And the acts of hanging greens and listening to the words of the prophets and seers, let us make our hearts and this space a place of inward and outward preparation for the one who comes to give us second birth.
Come and we will.
do we do this? What does it mean? During the Advent season, we prepare for the one who has come, whom we expect to come, and who will come again. We prepare our hearts and make room for the Messiah. We recall God's entering history as one of us in God's Son, Jesus Christ. We prepare our hearts so that God will find room and expression in our lives. In the hanging of the greens, we share with Christians throughout the ages the memory and anticipation of Christ's coming. We decorate our church with the symbols of love, joy, hope, and peace. Why do we do this? To tell the story again. Jesus Christ is born. What does it mean? God with us. Let us stand and sing, number 142.
For many months during the season the church calls ordinary time, the color used to decorate the sanctuary has been green. Green symbolizes growth both in our Christian lives and in each place where church has witness. During Advent, we changed the paraments to blue, the color of hope. For many churches, the use of the color blue during the season is new, since purple, the color used to symbolize repentance during Lent, has long been the traditional color for Advent. In recognition that Advent's mood of hopeful anticipation is not the same as Lent's focus on repentance, many churches have adopted blue as the color of the season. The color blue represents the night sky before creation. Reflecting on that time before the first dawn, we anticipate the wondrous work that God would do. During Advent, blue reminds us that we are a people of hope as we look forward to all that will be accomplished to bring God's kingdom into its fullness.
Awake, awake, and breathe the morn, for angels herald its dawning. Sing out your joy, for soon he is born, behold the child of our longing. Come as a baby weak and poor, to bring all hearts together. He opens wide the heavenly door, and lives now inside us forever.
Rejoice, rejoice, safeguard the night, for The Advent wreath is a simple circle of evergreen branches. The evergreen testifies to the continuation of life, and bending the branches so the ends touch to form a circle reminds us of light, life without end. Four candles encircle a central Christ candle. The candles signify God's Son as the light of the world. There are four candles for the 4 weeks of Advent. As we see the darkness of the world and the darkness of the winter season, we are witnesses to the Word of God come into the world, the light for all people. The light comes into the world, shines in the darkness, and is never extinguished. Christ is the light of the world. Three of the candles are blue, the color of hope and anticipation, which we use in this season. But the candle for the third week is rose. It symbolizes joy, as we remember that we need not await Christ's coming with fear, for we are welcoming one who loves us. Because of this, we wait for Christ with jubilation. Today, we light the first candle, the candle of hope.
Christmas greens have their origin in pagan cultures. Their use was incorporated into Christian worship by those who saw in them a deeper, richer meaning for the church. Laurel and bay symbolize victory and triumph. Yew and cypress point to the eternal life. Mistletoe symbolizes peace. The prickly leaves of the holly are the symbol of the crown of thorns. The circle shape of wreaths symbolize the eternal nature of God and God's eternal love, which has no beginning or end. Through the color green, the color of life, we celebrate God's gift of life, both in the present and for eternity.
Thank you.
Hear this reading from the Word of God, from Jeremiah chapter 33, verses 14 through 16. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 21, verses 25 to 33. There will be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of heaven will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away.
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Children, will you come and join me on the steps for a message just for you? Well, we have been decorating our sanctuary today. Have you been doing some decorating at home?
Yes, we have a Christmas tree.
You have a Christmas tree up. What's on your Christmas tree? Is it just a bear?
No, there's like ornaments, and the first one I put on was Pikachu.
We have a Pikachu ornament on the Christmas tree. We are ready for the holiday. What about you guys? Do you have decorations at your house?
Yep.
What kinds of decorations do you have? Say it so they can hear you too.
We got lights. And we got ornaments on our thingies. And we have
candy canes.
Candy canes, okay?
And we have a lot of food.
All right. So do you have anything you want to add? What else do you have at your house? Two Christmas blow-ups out in the front yard? And what?
I have something I want.
Okay.
We also have an nutcracker named Fred Tchaikovsky, who's exactly like an elf, only if you touch him, his magic doesn't go away. And we have like this little thing with a bunch of Christmas decorations, and where he was there.
It is so exciting to get our houses and our church ready for Christmas. Well, do any of you have one of these at your house? Yes. Oh, the opposite of yes. She says the opposite of yes. That means no. Took me a second. Do you know what this is called? It's a poinsettia. Yes. It's a real one. It's a real one. And we have some, there are some up here, lots up here actually, and there'll be a whole lot of poinsettias in our sanctuary before Christmas comes. Well, have you asked why? Oh, I'm so glad you asked why. That's a great question. We're going to talk about why we think of this particular flower, the poinsettia, at Christmas time. There is a legend about this flower that I want to share with you. The legend comes from Mexico. That's where these flowers grow. You know this legend? Oh, good, good. Then you can help me if I forget any details. So my story is about a little girl whose name was Lucita. Now, in the legend, she gets lots of different names depending on who's telling the story, but we'll call her Lucita.
I think I remember this legend, but I only
You might have read it. There's some really good picture books of this story. Well, Lucita lived in a small village in Mexico. And in her village, as throughout her country, on Christmas Eve, people would gather in the church. It was such a special and important night of the year. And the tradition in those churches was to bring gifts, to have a processional down the aisle of the church, and bring gifts to lay at the manger to show love for baby Jesus. Oh, people would make handmade blankets, maybe carve little baby toys. They would make special foods, all kinds of wonderful things to bring to the manger to show love and reverence for Jesus. Well, Lucita was very excited about Christmas, but she was not excited about the Christmas Eve service. She was actually sad about it because her family didn't have anything to spare. There was nothing in her house that she could take to the manger on Christmas Eve. They were a very, very poor family. And there were not even a few coins in the house that she could take to buy something to bring to the manger or even to buy some materials to make a gift to bring to the manger. She felt terrible. She didn't know what she was going to do on Christmas Eve. Well, Christmas Eve night finally came. And Lucita was walking with the other children from the village toward the church. And she was walking with her cousin, Pedro. And he could see how sad she was. And he wanted to offer something that would help her feel better. And Pedro said, "You know, Lucita, whatever you bring to baby Jesus, he will be honored if you bring it with love." Well, she was almost to the back door of the church, and she looked around to see if there was anything at all she could bring. And all she saw was an ugly patch of scraggly green weeds. She shrugged her shoulders. She didn't know what else to do. And Lucita gathered up some of those scraggly green weeds, a big armful of them. And she was the very last child to walk into the church at the very end of the line. And she walked down the aisle of the church and she took that armload of green weeds and she laid them down at the manger. And she could hear behind her people saying, "Tsk, tsk, tsk. How could Lucita bring weeds into the church? What is she doing? What is she thinking? Those weeds are so ugly." She felt so sad that what she had to offer was not special at all. She turned around and she started to walk back down away from the manger. So she had her back to the manger now. And she heard throughout the church a gasp. People went, "Oh, can you gasp? Oh, can you gasp? Yeah, there we go." Oh, the people gasped. And she wondered what it was that made the people gasp. And she turned around to look and she saw that where she had laid the green weeds, there were now beautiful red flowers. Flowers that were shaped like stars, that looked like the stars that shone in the night sky over the manger in Bethlehem. Yes, so that's why. That's exactly why. Lucita realized that the gift she had brought was good enough. It was a wonderful gift because she brought it with love and she brought the very best that she had to offer. And so at Christmas time, we decorate with poinsettias. We put them all over to remind us that Jesus wants us to bring our very best. And any gift we bring with love is a gift that honors Jesus. And so when you see a poinsettia, you can remember the legend of the poinsettias and Lucita and her special gift. Let's offer a prayer together. Loving God, we thank you that you love us and that you accept the gifts we bring. We love you and we want to honor you this Christmas. Help us to do our very best to love others as you would have us do, for we know that is the gift that honors you most. Thank you for coming to earth as a baby at Christmas. Amen. All right, you may go back to your seats, and the ladies from the choir are going to share with us a song about poinsettias.
My friend poinsettia. The Christmas tree is a wonderful sign of God's faithfulness. Never losing its green color, the Christmas tree reminds us of God's steadfast love, which endures forever. Legend has it that Martin Luther was the first person to decorate his home with a Christmas tree. Luther was walking home on Christmas Eve when he saw the glitter of stars shining through the snow-covered branches of the fir trees. Luther was so awed by the sight that he took one of the trees home with him and placed candles on the branches to demonstrate to his family what a glorious sight he had seen. From this first Christmas tree in the Luther household, the custom spread. Now, Christmas trees are used in homes, in churches, and in communities, wherever the birth of Christ is celebrated and the love of Christ is shared.
Chrismans. Chrismans, meaning Christ monograms, are often displayed on an evergreen tree during the Advent and Christmas seasons. These Christian symbols are typically white, the liturgical color for Christmas signifying Christ's purity, and gold, which symbolizes his majesty. Symbols such as stars, crosses, fish, crowns, and the Alpha and Omega remind us of Christ's identity, his story, and of the Holy Trinity. Chrismans were first developed in 1957 by Frances Spencer and the women of the Ascension Lutheran Church in Danville, Virginia. The idea quickly spread to other churches. Chrismans are not something a church buys, but rather it is traditional for congregations or Christian groups to focus on a few Chrisman symbols they find most meaningful and to make the ornaments they will display. In our sanctuary, the Chrismans hang on the Christmas tree and also adorn the communion table.
Thank you. the Nativity. Perhaps the most well-known of all Christmas traditions is the scene of the stable where the birth took place. Luke's gospel says that Mary laid her baby in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. From that verse arose the tradition that Jesus was born in a barn or in a cave where animals were kept. Most nativity sets include Mary and Joseph, the infant Jesus in the manger, and the shepherds who left their flocks to come and worship him. While the visit of the Magi, which Matthew records, would not have happened on the night of Jesus's birth, but perhaps as much as 2 years later, many nativity sets also include these royal figures. Angels, sheep, camels, and barnyard animals complete the scene. The Nativity reminds us that Jesus was born in humble circumstances and that even from the beginning, he was recognized as worthy of worship.
Gift of Christmas. For many of us, the Advent season is a time in which we prepare to give gifts to our family and friends on Christmas Day. We shop and make presents, then wrap them in festive paper as a way of showing our love for those who are special to us. But the greatest gift of Christmas is the gift of God come down to earth in Jesus Christ. God chose to share in our earthly human life, to live among us and share in our human experience fully. All that we do at this holy season points to that expression of God's abundant love. Christ came as a babe in Bethlehem, God's gift at Christmas. And that gift is life, hope, and a future reconciliation between God and all humankind. May we share in the gifts of wonder, hope, and love that are offered to us this Advent season.
As our service comes to its close, we do invite each of you to join us upstairs for our Advent market. We have soup and cookies for sale, as well as many handcrafted items for Christmas celebration. And now as we go from this place, may we do so celebrating the hope, the peace, the joy, and the love that come to us in this Advent season and throughout the year. Gifts from our good, ever-present God. Go in peace. Amen.